live from the Washington, D.C. area. It's the Inside Scoop, all the news that our viewers want to know. Now, here's the host.
Welcome to Inside Scoop. I'm your host, Catherine Read, and tonight we're talking with Diane Burkley Alejandro. She is the lead advocate for ACLU People Power Fairfax. Thank you so much for being here, Diane.
Thank you for inviting me. This is a great opportunity.
So I have to give a nod to Bruce Waxman, who introduced the two of us.
Yes.
And told me about Fairfax County's trust policy, which I confess, I was not aware of this policy, which was passed in January of 2021. Now, you're an attorney by training, and obviously you have been working in this arena of immigration and the interests of immigrants who are here in Fairfax County. So I would love for you to, first of all, give us some background on ACLU, People Power Fairfax, for people who are not familiar with that organization, and then basically how this trust policy came about.
Sure. ACLU People Power Fairfax was started in 2017. Now that date might be significant to you for many reasons. We had a new president. Most of us were disgusted by the vitriol, and one of the areas of vitriol that he focused on was that immigrants were rapists and murderers and not the best people, and that we should put up a wall. And then we had the Muslim ban. All this was going on at a time where many of us in Fairfax wanted to figure out what could we do. Well, ACLU helped us come because we've been going to marches, you know, doing a lot of the things that the progressives were doing, but what could we do that was concrete? And ACLU gave us a platform that allowed us to set up grassroots organizations in local areas, and we coordinate with ACLU on the issues, but we don't report to them. It's a volunteer organization. There are actually about 4,000 members in Fairfax.
Oh, wow, that's impressive.
Yeah. Now, I wish I could get 4,000 people to show up
for your events and your
actions. Yeah, but they, you know, there's a broad interest in this area, and other groups work on other issues. You don't have to work on immigration. But it struck a chord with me and with a number of other people in Fairfax. So we joined together and we started studying what was going on. And it became clear to us that there was so much you could do at the local level and some at the state level, even if we had a president who was anti-immigrant, that we could make a difference. And, you know, there are 350,000 immigrants in Fairfax County. That's 30% of our population. And right now, every day, 7 of them are captured for deportation by ICE. 7 a day.
That's shocking, really. And especially because it almost sounds like it's a safari. And, you know, they go out looking for people to deport. Like, it does not sound like it's a safety issue. It sounds almost like it's just a matter of how many can you catch. Or that's how it sounds to me.
There is a lot of mystery in how ICE decides capture someone, arrest them, they call it arrest, but really we're talking about civil violations here. We're crossing the border, coming to this country, your visa expired. That's not a criminal violation. It's a civil violation. It's like violating, you know, overstating your deductions, right? You know, it's bad. But these are people. These are human beings who have come here By and large, because life was not good where they came from, and they want a better life for their kids. There's violence, drugs, all sorts of issues that made it unsafe for them. So that's why they come here, by and large. I was struck with watching the Ken Burns program that's been on about U.S. and the Holocaust, because we faced a situation there where so many Jewish refugees wanted to come to the country. And what stopped them was that the immigration laws were set up to basically let in a few white Christian folks from Western Europe. And the Jews did not fit in that mold. And there were many people then as now who were saying, we don't want these bad people to come in. So we face that situation now, and putting aside that the horror may be different in their country, it's still horror. It's still horror. And we felt that we have an obligation, and this is where ACLU comes in, of, we're talking about fairness and equity here. Our immigration laws are broken. We're not going to fix them. This Congress can't do anything, right?
It seems to be true, yes.
We're not going to fix the immigration laws anytime soon. So you have hundreds and thousands of folks who are in, want to come for a better life, and we have jobs to give them. We have jobs to give them that need to be filled. So it's a win-win to let immigrants come in and help this economy grow, and they give back to the community in taxes and in purchasing power. So, why not let the good people that come from many, many different countries in here to help the United States? And they're just, so it made sense to us that this was an issue we wanted to work on. And we found out that law enforcement in Fairfax and other places like Fairfax at the local level are the biggest contributors to how ICE finds out that someone is undocumented. So we started to work to see what changes we could make at the local level, not to prohibit, not to violate federal law, but if there's something that calls for voluntary compliance by a local government that you don't have to do something, then don't do it. If the federal law says, you have to comply with the judicial warrant, absolutely you want that to be done. But we don't need to do that with someone who has committed a civil violation, has been here for 10 years, has children born in the U.S. It's just, there should be standards that allow
For mitigating circumstances, and you just mentioned one, people who've been here a long time, they have American-born children here, they have a life here, they have a family here, and they're contributing members of our community until they get pulled over for a driving violation, just as an example of someone discovering that perhaps the reason they don't have a driver's license is because they're undocumented. And so then all of a sudden the crime that has been committed is what thing? And yet they're taken into custody and they're processed for deportation. And I don't see how this makes our communities healthier or safer, or how it's contributing to the foundation of our communities, which is families. Supporting healthy families and giving them a path forward for their children and for their own livelihood.
Most of the people that are deported have been stopped by law enforcement for minor violations. You know, we're talking low-level misdemeanors. You mentioned the driving without a license. That's a big one. Drunk in public. You know, all these trespassing. What are we doing that someone who is accused of that minor crime is then taken to ICE now? And I say accused because we don't wait till they're convicted to
right.
turn them over to ICE.
Right.
All they have to do is be accused. So if you have a police officer who doesn't like the way you dress or the way you look, and decides that you're gonna get a citation or you're gonna be put in jail, whereas someone else, you know, like me,
or like
a
me.
White, you know,
right.
a white woman.
Right, so
nope.
we're driving without a license and oops, you know, they were just expired or it's in my other purse or whatever. And so the numbers, the data actually bear out this incredible disparity in the citations given to, for instance, Hispanic drivers and non-Hispanic drivers.
Right. The data is tremendous. And I will, just to make sure that I say the numbers right, when you have individuals stopped for driving without a license, Latino drivers, 81% of them are put in jail or custodially arrested, 81%. On the other hand, only 13% of non-Latino drivers are put in jail. And police also have an option. Traffic violations are particularly weird because you can do what's considered an arrest or you can issue a traffic citation. That being the sort of lesser or even warning, which is even, you know, of lesser consequence. But only 10% of Latino drivers are given a citation versus 83% of everyone else. So the bottom line there is Latino drivers are put in jail.
Yeah.
And if you're white, you go home. You may get a warning, you may get a citation, you may have to pay a fine, but you go home.
And so what does this mean once somebody's taken into custody because of a traffic violation and then they start to check their background, right? So this is sort of a gateway to checking on someone's status.
Right, and that's why they call it a jail to deportation pipeline, and it really starts with the arrest because it doesn't matter anymore, honestly, whether they end up in jail. ICE can find you through the databases, and that's a big problem that when we get back to talk about the trust policy, we'll talk about, because the data that people collect for the county government, but most especially for law enforcement, is accessible by ICE, and that's scary. ICE is now a domestic surveillance organization.
Which is why I can understand why the ACLU has lifted this up, because the ACLU has dramatically stated their opposition to the fact that we live in a surveillance country now. I mean, the reading license plates and storing that information. The ACLU has stepped up on many occasions to say that this type of surveillance, tracking ordinary citizens for no reason, you
right.
have no cause whatsoever to track the movements of people around the Commonwealth of Virginia. We're going to come back after a break, and we're going to talk further to Diane Alejandro about ACLU People Power Fairfax.
Caitlin, be serious. Now take the oath. Come on.
I'm totally taking this seriously.
Okay, I'm ready.
You may begin. I pledge that I will never meet in person with anyone I first met online without checking with my parent or guardian.
And
furthermore, if my parent or guardian agrees to the meeting, it will be in a public place and my parent or guardian must come along.
Do you pinky swear?
I do.
When you teach your kids about internet safety, they'll pass it on. For more information, go to cableclicksmart.org.
It was the biggest race of the year. And no matter what, I was gonna win. Sometimes things happen you just can't explain.
Oh, I believe there are angels among us.
And some things are more important than winning.
Send down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me.
I don't remember who won the race that day.
To show us how to live.
And I'll never forget how I felt.
Teach us how to give, to guide us.
Including others. Pass it on. A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
We're back to the Inside Scoop. Here again, your host.
Welcome back to Inside Scoop. I'm your host, Catherine Read, and tonight we're talking with Diane Alejandro. She is with ACLU People Power Fairfax, and they have been working on a trust policy in collaboration with Fairfax County. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you, Catherine.
So let's talk a little bit. We talked a little bit in the first segment about sort of the environment that we inherited, and especially it was exacerbated after 2017 because of the focus on immigrants and immigration policy.
Right.
And basically, we were to eradicate immigrants at all costs from our communities. So give us a background on where this trust policy came from and how it was developed and it was actually passed.
It was actually passed, which is pretty astounding. And a shout out to Fairfax County Board of Supervisors for doing that. They are the first in the Commonwealth to have passed a trust policy. Arlington has followed suit, although I, no offense to Arlington, but I tend to call it trust policy light.
Okay, not quite as robust.
Not quite as robust, but it's a great step in the right direction to have passed this. And basically what it's doing is prohibiting voluntary cooperation with ICE. And as we talked at the end of the last segment, a big focus is on limiting ICE's access to information.
Right.
So, you know, do we have information that the county's collecting that they don't need to collect? I've seen forms that have social security numbers, date of birth, place of birth on it. Do you need that information to do your job? Probably not in most cases.
We wouldn't be asked that, right? If we were stopped for a citation, would somebody ask me where I was born?
Well, this is probably not. This probably comes back in on, say, you're asking for benefits or something from the county government. You have a form to fill out to do that. For school. Schools had place of birth listed on the form and nationality, and you know, for someone who's undocumented, that's a very loaded question. And the schools have always said, well, we keep that information secure. ACLU believes that no data is secure from ICE, and we have examples of across the country where ICE is able to access local agency data without the agency even knowing about it.
Oh.
So this is Big Brother, you know.
So anything that's kept can be compromised, in other words. If you're collecting it can be compromised whether you know it or not.
Right. And you have to, I mean, obviously, if you need the information to do your job, then you need to collect it. And there will be examples of that come up. But what we're asking the agencies to do is to start off with, think about what information you need. Review your forms, figure out, Do you need someone's phone number? Do you need their address? A lot of times the answer is yes, and that's fine, but it should be an intentional decision because you have to assume that it's going to be accessible once it's in government records. Now, we want to do everything to keep it not accessible, too.
Right.
But, you know, if you operate from the assumption that we don't collect more than we need, then the pool is smaller
right.
for what ICE can get its hands on. So that's a big part of what the trust policy is designed to do. The goal really is not only to stop these low-level offenses that we talked about before blowing into a deportation, that basically where you're taking a crime if someone's drunk on a Friday night means that they're deported, basically like an exile life sentence. Is that a fair consequence? But it also keeps families together. Up to 85% of immigrant families are a mix of legal permanent residents, U.S. citizens, often the children, and undocumented residents. And when one of them gets deported, and by the way, sometimes that's a U.S. citizen by mistake, or someone with the green card, but you know, whoever it is, when one of them gets deported, the trauma to the family is horrendous, especially the children. It just causes such severe psychological damage. It causes economic damage. Most of the time, it's about 70% reduction in income when one of the primary breadwinners is deported. I mean, how can a family survive on that? And these are not folks who come to the U.S. to get on the federal dole, right?
Because they come here for opportunity, and they're willing to work very, very hard.
Very hard. And they pay, you know, in Fairfax, they pay $5 billion in taxes. This is not inconsequential.
No.
So they help all of us. And but what happens if you have a deportation is that person then is forced to seek public benefits, and yet a lot of them will be denied public benefits if they too are undocumented. So people that come here that are unauthorized to be here, they don't come here to get welfare because you can't qualify for welfare.
For it anyway, right? You can't
right?
get any benefits, yep.
Yeah, so, you know, you come here to get a job and work as hard as you can and make a better life for your kids, which is the American way.
It's the American dream. That's why immigrants have come here to our shores since 1619.
Right, right. So that's what we were trying to accomplish, and we started meeting with the sheriff, with the police chief, with various members of the Board of Supervisors, and we made some headway, but this is starting in 2017. We realized after about a year of that it was going to take a pretty substantial high-level policy to get some meaningful changes. So that's when we came up with the idea of the trust policy, and there were a couple different variations. There was a group we were part of initially, Fairfax for All, who came up with an ordinance. And I helped draft that ordinance. It's had some good provisions. Politically, I felt that we were better off seeking a policy because we have more likelihood of getting that passed than an ordinance. But we were coming up, you may recall, as we got 2018, 2019, we're coming up on Board of Supervisor elections.
Yeah.
So this is always a good opportunity to have folks put their money where their mouth is, right?
Right.
So that's what we came up with, a pledge that was a commitment that as soon as they became supervisor, the individual would adopt a trust policy to end voluntary cooperation and information sharing. And we got 20 candidates.
Wow.
To sign
20.
That.
That's a lot.
Yeah. And of the folks that are on the board now, nine of them supported it, seven of them signed it. There are a few like Penny Gross who said, yeah, I don't sign anything.
Yeah, that sounds like Penny.
You know, but I'll support you. But when the trust policy passed, it passed by 9-1.
Right.
So, you know, this was a tremendous victory. We held them to that commitment. We did, you know, what every good group has. And we have folks who do focus on, you know, it's kind of like getting the vote out, but it's
right,
not political, because we would not, you know, ACLU is not partisan
right,
that way. So we were doing it on the issues. And, but we did questionnaires for all the candidates, what their stance was on particular immigration issues, and then we had the commitment. And Chair McKay took the lead on this, and he became our ally in John Faust, and then we started adding to that. You know, that's a pretty good starting point.
Oh, it definitely is. And I kudos that this was signed in January of 2021, because 2020 was a very tough year. So,
yes,
you know, this got signed and it was passed 10 months after the whole world shut down from COVID.
Right.
So it's kind of amazing that you were able to continue to push this effort even though everything was shut down.
Thank God for Zoom, right?
Yeah, we all learned how to Zoom, right? I think the whole
yeah,
country is suffering from Zoom fatigue at this point.
Yeah, indeed. And texting, you know, we were lucky that by that point we had good contacts with a number of the supervisors, and we had met with all of them. It took a lot of work, and it took a lot of coalition building, too. You know, we didn't do this alone. We were the lead in terms of drafting and negotiating with the Fairfax board, but we worked hand in hand with CASA. We worked hand in hand with, you know, up to 50 immigration groups that all got their members to say, we support this. This is an important thing to do. And we had a number of comments given at board meetings by immigrants who, you know, the stories are just so, so sad. And about their fear of living here, fear of contacting police. I know there's a woman who lives in near Route 1.
Mm-hmm.
Who had a domestic violence situation and called the police on her husband. And by the time the policeman came, they had resolved matters and she did not want to press charges, so the policeman went home.
Yeah, well, it's good that nothing worse happened.
Oh, you don't know the second half of the
well,
story.
Well, after our break, we're
okay,
going to come back and listen to the second half of the
okay,
story. So we are talking with Diane Alejandro, and she is talking about Fairfax County's trust policy and some of the human stories behind why this policy is necessary to have healthy, safe communities within such a large county. So please join us after this break.
Do you love sports? Then you should know about STEM. Because maximizing nutrition, analyzing peak muscle performance, calculating the perfect shot, and more are all made possible by science, technology, engineering, and math. In fact, there are more careers than ever in sports science. So if you have a passion for sports, then think about getting involved in STEM and improve everyone's game on and off the field. Get inspired at SheCanSTEM.com.
What to expect when you're expecting a teenager.
Hey guys, today we're talking about how to wake up your teen, and this works literally every time.
Give kisses. Give kisses. Look. Give kisses. Give kisses. You heard how loud that was.
I know,
sleep
I heard,
through that.
I heard. It wasn't you.
Yeah.
It was the...
Is that bacon?
You don't have to know it all to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care will love you just the same.
Bacon.
Bacon. We're back to the Inside Scoop. Here again, your host.
Welcome back to Inside Scoop. I'm your host, Catherine Read, and tonight we're talking with Diane Alejandro. She is with ACLU, People Power Fairfax, and we're talking about Fairfax County's trust policy. So when we went to our break, you had told us about a domestic violence situation where the police were called, it was resolved, and there's a second half to that story that we didn't get.
Yes. The second half of the story is that the next day, a different policeman who had not been involved in the service call came to the house and arrested the husband. The wife had not changed her mind. She was not charging him. The matter was resolved. He was taken to Fairfax Jail. They dismissed the charge within a day or two, but in the meantime, ICE picked him up and he was deported.
You know, and that just, I'm sure it was devastating in an already devastating situation. It was not helpful, really.
It's not helpful to that family. It's not helpful for public safety. And I think there's a larger theme. It's like, even if you don't care, even if you feel that those individuals should be deported, I think we have to look at the broader picture of what this does for public safety for all of us. There are people who have said on the record, you would be a fool to call the police to report anything, domestic abuse, witnessing a murder, don't call the police. Because you or someone you know, and remember 85% of these families are mixed status.
If
right. It's not you that's deported, it could be your husband, your uncle. Is it worth the risk of interacting with police when you or your family can face the consequences? So what does that do for community public safety?
In the fact, it all boils down to trust. How do we trust each other? How do we live in communities? How do our children go to school with other children and not live in fear if we don't have this basic trust that what we care about is the safety and well-being of all of the children in our schools and
right.
the people who live in our communities. So talk a little bit about the county school board's position on the trust policy.
The county, you know, Fairfax government is Byzantine and we have all these different tranches of who's in charge of what. The county believes it cannot tell the school board what to do. So we had to go to the school board and convince them to issue their own school trust policy. And the school board has been tremendous. It took them a year. It passed unanimously. And what I like most about it is that the one they worked with, our group and Eddie Futuro, a number of different groups, to come up with provisions that made sense, and they're implementing it vigorously. They mandated training of every individual employee. They have signage. They have when you come in the office and this is what it tells you, because there, I don't know if you saw, there was one heartbreaking in another jurisdiction of a five-year-old sitting there who had run away from school, and the police are there talking to the staff about what a troublemaker he was, and he came from a broken home.
I think it was Prince George's County.
Yeah.
Yep. And it was pretty awful to hear law enforcement talk that way about a child.
I know. And scream in his face, but the school staff was as bad. They said, oh, he's always been that way. His mother's from, El Salvador or whatever, and she doesn't, this and that. And just giving away all this personal information, it was horrible. They are really implementing it at many levels. I got hundreds of pages, good old school policies, But they seem to really be trying to get that on the ground and running. Now, that just passed last April. So it's pretty new.
Okay.
Yeah, and this is the first school year that it's been in place. So we'll have to watch and see how it goes, but I am very optimistic about the work that they are doing and that they're going to help reduce the fear of immigrant families there. And shout out to Carl Fritz and McCarty Anderson, who took the lead on this. They were fantastic.
Well, that's always good to hear.
Yeah.
I do think we have a good county school board. And I do think that they show up every day to make school work for all the children.
Right.
And are committed to that.
Yeah.
But going back to the county, so the policy's been in place much longer, and yet accountability, training, what are some of the data points you're seeing now after a year and a half?
Well, one of the things we looked at was to see if there was any change in deportation rates. Because in most places, when they issue a non-cooperation policy, a trust policy, deportations are within a couple months reduced by a third to a half. And you don't see that in Fairfax. I mentioned before the 7 a day ICE deportations. They're about in the last 4 years since the county started moving toward non-cooperation. We've had 10,000 new deportation cases in Fairfax County.
That's a lot.
1 in 12 Latino residents is facing deportation. 1 in 12. This is just horrible. So we did that. We were already concerned because of the county's failure to do some of the things that they promised to do in the trust policy, but that of course just took us over the top, we've worked with other groups to try and get the attention of the Board of Supervisors to change this, because they have requirements in the trust policy that they have not implemented. It's not a self-implementing document, and that's what the 150 pages on the school board, that shows you. You have to turn this into specific guidelines, and we have a requirement in the trust policy that every agency issue a directive that explains what information they collect, whether it's required by law or is it required for the agency's mission, like with the police, for public safety.
Right.
And not a single agency has issued that. They were supposed to be completed by July of 2021. Not a single agency has done that. And at the same time, you talk about police in particular, the police have been revising a lot of their general orders. So we've been trying to work with them to see if, okay, you're not issuing a directive, how about we put the directives in your general orders on the topics that you're talking about, like arrests? And Chief Davis told us, oh, No, because the rest are not subject to the trust policy. And I'm like, excuse me? Or as ACLU's Mary Bauer, who's the executive director, said, that's just plain stupid. For 18 months, they took that position. And so they did not change their directives of how they collect information during arrests or stopping police or traffic or any of that. Not a single change. But they maintain, we support the trust policy and we comply with it. I'm going, but you haven't complied with it because you have not issued your directive. You know, so that's a huge omission on the part of the county, and it's very troubling because let's face it, this is something that's required of department heads. If the department heads are not complying, how can you expect employees
on the front lines to comply with something that actually hasn't even been issued?
Yeah, because the employee's duty is to comply with the directive. Because tell me, if you and I looked at, you know, do we need a person's address or social security number to, if we're talking to them, a policeman talking to them on the street, we might come up with different answers.
Right, we might. And that goes down to an individual having to make a judgment call in the face of not having a policy that gives them the direction either you do or you don't.
Right. And we just want them to take a stand. Is this required? For 9 months, the police published online the name and address and full date of birth of everyone arrested in Fairfax County. This is 9 months after the trust policy was passed. That's illegal. That information is not required to be put online for public safety. And it took us 9 months of fighting to get that information taken off and intervention by the chair. And kudos to Jeff McKay for taking it off, but shouldn't have taken 9 months. You know, these are no-brainer issues if you are serious about complying with the trust policy. And again, it sends a message. And we want that message to be, when we say you don't cooperate with ICE, we mean it, and here's how we're gonna show you. We're gonna do what we promised to do, and they haven't so far.
Well, as you said, they're kind of a behemoth of a government. I mean, you know, we have a county government and population and geography that's bigger than some states in the United States. Yeah. But nevertheless, I think it's important that you're staying on top of this, that you continue to track the data, that your organization, which is a grassroots organization, and it's a coalition of people who are working on many different levels to kind of oversee whether or not there's implementation happening, that there's accountability that's happening. And so when we come back from our break, I want you to kind of help us understand going forward, what are you going to do to kind of ensure that your group is always looking over the shoulders and giving feedback? It sounds like Jeff McKay is sincere in wanting this to be implemented in a thoughtful, definable, trackable way. I think what's missing is how that's going to start and how you're gonna oversee it. But anyway, when we come back from our break, we'll be talking with Diane Burkley Alejandro. She is an attorney by training. She works with ACLU, People Power Fairfax, and she is one of the people who has spearheaded the trust policy that we now have here in Fairfax County.
Let me tell you about the toughest guy on earth. He does the work of two jobs, but only gets paid for one. He's tough enough to feed the man that gave him a lifetime of nourishment. He has the crazy strength to lift the man that raised him up without even flinching. That's right, no employee of the month bonus check here. This warrior, will always be by his father's side, even if his dad will hardly remember. Good luck finding a gym to train for that.
If this guy isn't the toughest guy on the planet, then I don't know who is. Caregiving is tougher than tough. Find the care guides you need at aarp.org/caregiving.
Listen to smoke before you give it a try.
Only you.
Don't play with matches. Don't play with fire.
Fire.
Cause there's nothing very funny about fire. Nothing very nice.
A holy smile.
So if a gorgeous force is what you desire, don't play with matches.
Don't play with fire.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Fire.
We're back to the Inside Scoop. Here again, your host.
Welcome back to Inside Scoop. I'm your host, Catherine Read, and we're talking with Diane Alejandro of the ACLU People Power Fairfax. We are talking about Fairfax County's trust policy. So you have a coalition that not only got this policy developed and you got it passed and the school board adopted it, but now there's a coalition that's actually focused on the implementation, which I think you have pointed out is something that just doesn't happen by itself. There have to be directives that has to come from the top. There has to be a plan, and part of that plan is measuring whether or not these directives and the implementation are actually working as designed. How's that going?
Well, we are hopeful, but we think it's going to take a lot of voices to be heard. And we started that process by developing this coalition. Because you know how it is, you solve one problem and you think it's solved. And you know, Jeff McKay and the board, they're human. They have other problems right to work on. So they move on. And so we decided we really needed to let the board know that this isn't working. You did a great thing in passing it, but so far you have not implemented it. So we formed a coalition, and it has 50 different immigration advocacy groups and community groups who join forces. Because they hear from me all the time, right? You know, I'm sure
because you're
sick.
focused on this, right? This is something that it's not enough to just say you're going to do something. It has to be done.
Right. And so we wanted them to know that the immigrant community is watching, and if you want trust, you have to earn it. You took a great big step by passing this. But I could not in good conscience tell immigrants on the street that they should trust the Fairfax County Police Department or the county until this policy is actually implemented. So we've got our eye on them, and we are working with the board. We think the board has to take further action. They have blown through deadlines. They said the deadline for the directives was 14 months ago. There are other provisions that just have not been implemented as well. The board has to focus on this, we believe, and that's what we're working on now. They need to focus on it, and they need to jumpstart it. So that's why we formed this coalition. Nine of us spoke. There was a tenth there, but he wasn't allowed to speak from Legal Aid Justice Center, John Cano. But you know, a number of immigrants and advocates spoke to the board at the September 12th meeting and put them on notice that we think changes need to be made, and now we're gonna work with them and hopefully get them to reinvigorate the trust policy. And they have done good things. They've hired a director of immigrant community affairs, so it's not like they're just sitting on their hands, but there's huge gaping holes. They want the employees to comply, but the department heads and the county executive have not complied. So they need to own up to the fact that they have work to do. And we're gonna do our best to hold them to that. Good intentions, I think Jeff McKay and other members of the board have great intentions. Their heart is in the right place, but it takes action. It takes resources. It takes intentional discussion and figuring out what the rules are that you're gonna hold employees to, because just telling them not to cooperate with ICE isn't gonna cut it.
It is a little vague. And you know, it seems to me too that when people have done their job a certain way for a long time, and then now you're asking them to unlearn what they believed was the way it should be done and to relearn something else. Mm-hmm. You know, this is a shift in culture. It's a shift in routines. Just in how you react in doing your job, especially with law enforcement. If you're being asked to unlearn something you've always done a certain way and then to relearn this new thing, and it seems to me there has to be reinforcement and support for that.
Right. Right. And that takes training, and it does take a culture shift, but you can't have those unless it starts from the top of showing that the department heads are willing to do the legwork. And let's face it, they're going to have their staff do it anyway, right? And they're going to sign it, but they have to put the resources in play to develop the directives and explain to employees how they expect them to act. And that we are hopeful will be done. If it's not done, then in my mind, this will be a failure. And it's sad for me to say that. I've worked for 5 years on it. I don't believe this board wants to fail. I think their heart is in the right place. But we just have to remind them. And we're hoping that the population, one of the reasons I'm so happy to talk to you about this is we need people.
Right.
We need people to let their supervisors know that they need to do their job when it comes to protecting immigrants, and that means implement the trust policy.
So you've got 50 coalition partners, and I looked at, I know a lot of them, some of them have been on this show, some of them have been on this show more than once. Uh-huh. And so I'm pondering to myself how each one of them is getting the word out to their supporters, their donors, their members, the people in the community that may not be focused on this trust policy, because I hadn't heard of it either. And I have connections with a lot of these organizations, and until Bruce Waxman said something to me, I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. Right. So in trying to get the information out generally to the public, you know, I'm wondering if your coalition partners have really focused on helping the people aligned with their organizations and missions understand this trust policy in terms that the average citizen goes, yes, this is going to benefit the safety and the health of our community by protecting children and families that are living here.
Right, right. I think that message could be got across better by all of us, you know, and I'm guilty of that too. It's we get caught in the details a lot. But I do know, you know, you mentioned Suk Young Luis Aguilar, they understand that message and they do spread the word on that. The dilemma a lot of groups have had on the trust policy is best summarized by what a comment that Abrar Omesh made when we were developing the school trust policy, which was, I don't want to tell immigrants that they don't have to be afraid anymore, unless that's really true. So what does that mean? She helped make sure that this implementation, you know, getting the guidelines, training, you know, really making it part of the school culture was a key part of the school trust policy. And that's a dilemma a lot of groups face now, because they want to advertise the trust policy, but until it's really seriously implemented, we don't want to tell, you know,
people that there's a policy that protects them if it doesn't in reality protect them.
Exactly. You got the dilemma. Yeah. There's the rub. So we have continued to focus. It's like, you know, there are other places like Fairfax City mm-hmm. who are not covered by the trust policy. And we'd like to start work on making sure that, you know, that was one of our original plans. Let's get Falls Church, Fairfax City, everybody make sure they have similar policies. And what's happened is we realized we have so much work to do with Fairfax County and the police in particular to make sure that there is meaningful protection, that we don't want to go selling it to other
jurisdictions,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
And we are a region, and I think people forget that too. Northern Virginia, people don't know when they're driving through Fairfax City when they're actually in the county.
Right.
Or you're in Arlington or Loudoun or Prince William. I mean, Northern Virginia is a huge region, and
right.
we are very multicultural and international with people here because of our proximity to Washington, D.C. There are people here from so many countries, and we should have as a region some consistency from one jurisdiction to another so that people feel that they are protected no matter where they are in Northern Virginia.
Right. And we want to hold Fairfax as a model. And I think the policy as written is a good model. And once we get the implementation guidelines, those should be a good model. And we're not going to stop just with Fairfax, and ideally it'd be great to have some protection at the Virginia level. You know, it's
yeah.
kind of difficult in the current circumstances, but we've made progress at the state level. There are now driver's privilege cards.
That's right. We have made strides.
Yeah. And privacy protection is not bad. We got that passed as well. A whole coalition of groups working on that.
Yeah, and I know that the ACLU has always put privacy issues right at the top of their
yeah.
of their goals, and that is for all Virginians
mm-hmm.
here. And I do think strides have been made. I am hopeful that they will not be rolled back or unraveled. There's a lot of reasons to think that that might happen in the future, but I hope it doesn't happen in the future.
Right.
So we have to be hopeful. 2023 is right around the corner. So
yeah.
I want to thank you, Diane. You have been so informative. I've really enjoyed talking to you and understanding more deeply what this policy is and how it's intended to work. And for you who are viewing at home, I hope you're intrigued by this too, and that you'll start asking questions and noticing things around you or talking to the organizations that you volunteer for or support to ask what they're doing too. This has been a really informative discussion. Thank you so much.